my name is David Kestenbaum. I'm an ESL teacher here in Greenfield Community College, and I'd like to thank the college for having me here to do this today. I'm going to give a slideshow on Zaskar and Ladakh, which are two Tibetan areas in northern India in the Jammu and Kashmir state. This was part of a two-year trip I made to Asia, actually in 1980. First, I'm going to start off showing just a few slides of Kashmir, which you'll see a contrast because Zaskar and Ladakh are very dry areas, in fact, the driest places in India, whereas Kashmir is very green. So the first few slides you're going to see are going to be in Kashmir, in which I took a trek over the mountains to a holy Hindu cave deep in the mountains of Kashmir. So this first slide is where I started out taking the trek up that canyon you can see there. These were a couple of pilgrims also taking this trip to this holy cave. It's called a sadhu. Sadhus are these wandering Hindu holy men. They wander all around India. They carry very few possessions. I think some of them are not allowed to stay in any place for more than a few days. This was on top of a pass on this pilgrimage. You can see some people are going there by horseback. These were a group of people from Jammu, I think Muslims, and in the summer they brought their herds up to the mountains. There's a man with his sheep. I guess they just spent the whole summer up in the mountains with their sheep. This is inside the cave. This is a group of sadhus. You can see, especially the one on the right, that's his hair matted on top of his head. That's what a lot of sadhus do. One thing I should mention about this cave, the reason it was a holy Hindu cave is because inside the cave there's an ice Shiva lingam, which is a fertility symbol, and it's claimed that this ice lingam rises during full moon and goes down when there's no moon, and it's snowed in most of the year, but in August thousands of pilgrims used to make a pilgrimage there to see it during the full moon. I actually went there a week before the full moon, and it was kind of disappointing. It was just a little kind of fallen over mound of ice. Later I heard that, you know, the sadhus were praying and putting snow on it, and I don't know, supposedly it was pretty good lingam by the time the full moon came around. This is the first picture heading into Ladakh. This is going over, this was actually taken from a truck, I think, or a bus, going over a pass into Ladakh. You can see it's very barren, and you can start to see the mountains are more colorful, and it's a desert. Then I headed to this place called Zaskar Valley. The reason I went there was because I heard that the Dalai Lama was there inaugurating a new temple, or what they call a gompa in Korean. This was heading through a valley towards there, and I guess it was after the harvest. You can see the people working there. The western part of Ladakh is a Muslim area. You can see the people there are Muslim, the women dressed in black with their heads covered. They're harvesting. You can see it was a very poor road. I was riding on the back of a truck, and we headed up somewhere up over those mountains. This was taken the next morning. We went over this pass on the truck. I remember the road kept winding and winding, and we'd pass a little village, and I think this has to be the last village, and then we'd pass another one. Then we started going over this pass as it was just before dark, and suddenly these huge mountains came into view. I remember up on the right, and then we went around a bend and they disappeared, and you know, that was that. Next, you know, we drove all night, and I slept outside by this village. This is more of now we're in the Tibetan area. You can see typical Tibetan houses. You know, they have flat roofs, and they keep the wood and the peat on the roof. Some of them are painted white. That place was called Rangdam. Then from there we headed towards Zaskar, and the road was, you know, at times I would say hardly even call it a road, and this was actually taken from the road you know, look down on this very long glacier. You see the mountains there are very totally barren and quite colorful. Then we were heading into Zaskar. You can see some of the small villages there, and I guess I was on a truck very much like that one. That was me after 2 days riding on the back of this truck. It was incredibly dusty, as you could tell. It was terrible. There were some locals on the truck and some other Westerners. I remember one Englishman, in spite of the dust and the bumpiness, was reading some book about demonic possession or something. I thought he was crazy. This was actually a woman. People don't wash very much around there. For one thing, there's no hot water. The rivers are ice cold. And, you know, it's windy and dusty. I think if you washed, you'd be very dirty again, you know, very soon. Okay, this was a new temple that was being inaugurated by the Dalai Lama. And, you know, all the people were arriving, were heading to the temple. You can sort of begin to see, you'll see better pictures. Anyway, the Dalai Lama was there, and it, of course, attracted hundreds of local people. Their complete costume was all locally made. Nobody was wearing anything from outside. You can see from the woman in the middle, they also have these big sort of earmuffs, and they wear these big silver necklaces. Here's a good view of one of their hats. I think they're called pikas. I can't really say why, but a lot of the men had their heads shaven with tuft of longer hair in the back. There's also a Ladakhi costume and Ladakhi hat. I guess he has a button of the Dalai Lama on his hat. There you can see even her shoes or booties seem to be local product. You can't really see him, but the Dalai Lama, I don't see him too well, but you know, here's the Dalai Lama, I guess, conferring with some of the monks.
Meeting the Dalai Lama.
Well, like I said, it was a very nice feeling. He seemed, you know, I looked up and saw this very nice smiling face. You know, it was interesting because, you know, I guess to all the local people, he was like a god, and they were constantly prostrating when he was there. And that was also a very, you know, good experience. I don't know if I get any good karma out of, you know, meeting him. I guess a lot of people are blessed by him. One morning I woke up and everybody was, you know, running out towards the temple, and then they were forming this huge line. It turned out everybody was being blessed by the Dalai Lama. It was a lot of fun. One reason was because I felt it was the first time these people had ever been in a line before in their lives. This is the line waiting to be blessed by the Dalai Lama. The other Westerners were an Englishman and an Australian woman who I traveled with them on the truck to get to Zaskar. I was on the line, as you could see. It was quite a long line. They checked my bag for security, and I had a Kashmiri knife which they took, which I think I managed to get back later. And then when they told me I should bow my head when I got up to the Dalai Lama. So I did, and then I heard him ask what country I was from, and I looked up into a nice smiling face and said, you know, USA, and he said, oh, USA, and, you know, that was that. Obviously, there was no time to chat with still many more people waiting to be blessed. This is a little bit farther down in the valley. It's a, you know, Buddhist temple and stupa. People go and walk around them 108 times and, you know, chant their Tibetan mantra while they do it, or they spin a prayer wheel. I got to walk through the new temple and was given some things, including just a piece of red string that I tied around my neck. And then after that, and they gave you a plate of food. This was actually a huge vat of rice being cooked to feed, you know, I guess hundreds of people. It's kind of an interesting photo, I think, because those pots in the back look kind of three-dimensional, or, you know, or as if they were painted by Rembrandt or something. I presume these girls are twins. They certainly look like it. Pretty amazing necklaces. All right, after staying in that part, I headed over to that monastery I pointed out, which was called Karsha. And I had to cross this very wide braided river. We hired a somebody to take us over on horseback, which was kind of interesting. I think, you know, I had to hold my feet up in the air in order for them not to get wet. It was pretty deep. Some locals were crossing on foot, which, you know, up to their chest at least. Also, the man we hired, the horse hired to take us across, you know, I think he charged us 5 rupees or something. And when we were halfway across, he wanted 10 more rupees. There's the Karsha Monastery. The monks live in all those white buildings up on the cliff there, and the red building is the temple. And the buildings in the foreground are where the villagers live. And I guess you can also see their fields. There's a closer view of the monastery. This is up by the temple. The Dalai Lama was coming to visit there, and they were fixing it up and putting up more decorations. You can also see way across the valley, towards the left, is another little village. That's kind of the main street in the village of Karsha. One of the paintings on the temple wall. I've been told that this is a Dharma guardian. Well, there's a monk looking out over the valley. And another detail of the temple. This was one of the local lamas or monks. I think he was in charge of one little temple off to the side I visited. These are female monks. They're called the chomos rather than lamas. They're quite a fun-loving group. I was going to do this trek to a place called Lamayuru over the mountains, and one of them said she was going to be my porter. These are some of the local people. The reason they're looking up like that is because the Dalai Lama had just gone up to the monastery. So you can see they're looking pretty rapt. Some of them are holding their hands in a prayer position. It was really an incredible experience. I was just sort of, and also that and the mountains around there and all the local people, I was just kind of shaking my head in amazement the whole time. And when there were some Westerners there, one Frenchman came over to me and said something like he didn't think it was that great. And I thought the guy was crazy. I didn't know what he was expecting. And then he told me they had mountains like that in France, which was absolutely ridiculous. I mean, they don't have anything like that in France. They don't have these desert, dry, very colorful mountains. So I don't know what that guy was thinking of. Anyway, back in Karsha Monastery, I guess the Dalai Lama was up in the temple up on the top, and all the monks were climbing up there. You can see some of them are carrying these big drums. And there are a couple carrying these huge horns that they play. All right, from Karsha, I made a trek over the mountains to a place called Lamayuru. One thing I should mention was one day I was going to set out and a strange thing happened in Karsha. For the Dalai Lama's visit, they brought an electric generator. And after he left, the truck that had the generator on it was going to leave, but the local people, and especially the monks, decided they were going to keep the generator. So they blocked the truck from leaving. I don't know, they may have been promised something, I don't know, but they wouldn't let the truck leave. So whoever was with the truck said they would go talk to somebody, the district commissioner, and then come back and tell his decision. So a few hours later, I happened to be walking up to the road there to start my trek with my backpack. And all of a sudden, this truckload of Indian, I don't know if they were state police or something, you know, carrying shields and these big sticks came. And at that point, there were only a few locals standing around, so all they did was push them out of the way, and the truck with the generator took off. However, some of the local people started fighting back with the police, and I was just kind of standing there. One of the local men was you know, fighting with the police, and he managed to take one of their sticks and was fighting with them. And they tackled him on the ground, and, you know, they could have easily just captured him, but they intended to beat him. And he managed, and, you know, this was like maybe 50 feet or less from where I was, and he got away from them and ran up, you know, and he was virtually right next to me, grabbed a rock and threw it at them, and then, you know, started running down towards a river, and some of them started chasing him down towards a river, which I think was 2 kilometers away. At that point, most of the police got back on their truck and left. But there were still some of them around. Suddenly there was a huge yell came from the monastery, and all these monks came running down. At this point, I decided to go back to my the place I was staying. And we went up on the roof there and watched as the monks chased, you know, whatever few of these police were still around, down towards the river. I couldn't see it, but somebody there, I guess, had very good eyes, said he saw some of the police go in the river and get carried away. Later, we found that 2 of the policemen had drowned in the river. Months later in India, I would read in the Indian newspapers about this, you know, they were still investigating this incident or something like that. Anyway, you can see the mountains are very colorful, and all kinds of striations in the rocks going every which way. Also, you can see not very many people around. I think I read that Ladakh had something like 2 people per square kilometer or square mile. You can see the trail. I think that was my trail there on the left of the river. After I walked several hours, I ran into these 2 young Germans who were doing the same trek. And they had met a couple of lamas who were hiking to their local village, so I attached on with them. This photo was taken the next morning as we were walking along the Zaskar River. So the reason the lighting is like that is because it was early morning. I think it was some sort of a palace or a ruined palace. It was up on the other side of the river. As I said, this is the driest place in India, which has, you know, 1 or 2 other deserts. Only thing is, you know, the valleys are between 10 and 14,000 feet high, and the mountains up to something like 22,000 feet. There's me on the left with one of the Germans, and that was the younger of the 2 monks we were with. His name was Noong. You can see I was incredibly skinny. This was after traveling in, you know, India and Nepal for quite a while and doing a lot of trekking in Nepal. I remember I hadn't really weighed myself, and I had the occasion to weigh myself, and I was shocked because I think I weighed less than I had in high school, and I was maybe 31 years old at the time. I remember I weighed 53 kilos, which is about maybe 116 pounds, and after that I was in Kathmandu, and I saw this Frenchman I knew, and I said, you know, I can't believe it, I only weigh 53 kilos. And he said, well, so what, I'm 50, he's 45, pointing to this other French guy at the table. This was the other monk we were walking with. His name was Atashi. You can sort of see from the picture, he was a bit of a conniver. This part of the hike, he was sort of constantly asking me to give him things. I was carrying some sugar. And I was constantly—they were constantly asking me for sugar, biscuits, other things I was carrying, which was fine. But you know, I sort of wanted to make them last the whole trek, which went well past, you know, where they were going. Also, there's Tashi and Noong. They were carrying, I don't know, something like 15 or 20 kilos of yak butter back to their monastery.
The language as you went.
No, I didn't really learn much of language. I remember hello was, or how are you, was Jule in Ladakhi. I probably knew how to say thank you, and you know, but like I said, I think Urdu was maybe the main language of Kashmir. That's kind of the you know, the Muslim equivalent of Hindi. It's the national language of Pakistan. I think the Kashmiri Muslims probably speak Urdu. And so the you know, the Ladakhis probably knew a few words, you know, a little bit of Urdu. You know, the you know, Nawang and Tashi were trying to learn a little English. They only knew a few words. Yeah, I mean, couldn't really communicate too much as far as language is concerned. Every few hours, there would be a small village with about 10 houses. In Tibetan Buddhism, they have these prayer walls on either side of the villages. They're called mani walls, and you can't really see, but all of these stones have a prayer or mantra carved on them. There's also, you know, one on the other side of the village. You're supposed to pass on to the left of it, so it's on your right, if I recall. All right, after a couple of days, we started to climb out of the Zaskar Valley. Some incredible canyon, I think, across the way. Then this was the first pass we had to go over. You can see the trail up here. I don't remember if that's one I went up or down. I might be looking back at it. I guess this was taken up near the top of one of these passes. It wasn't really that high. Now you can see the trail again on the right. It was either one I went up or down. Looks pretty steep. You can see a man sort of at the bottom of the picture. I guess, as far as I could tell, he lived there alone. I guess to position ourselves to cross this really high pass and get to their village the next day, we had to hike way up and camp way up in this narrow valley. I didn't know why we kept, you know, at the time, maybe I didn't really know why. I thought, you know, we just kept going up and up and up, and I guess it was starting to get dark. I couldn't understand why they were going up so high. I thought they were a bit crazy. I think this one was taken the next day. You can see that's actually a snow bridge there that we crossed. I guess probably one of the monks there in the picture. Then we kept going up this really narrow, you know, little gully. There was, you know, nothing there at all, very barren and gray. And it, you know, started to get really overcast and gray. It was a really bizarre place. We carried a tiny bit of wood that we picked up, and all of a sudden they stopped kind of in the middle of nowhere and started cooking some tea. And it started snowing. You know, these snow flurries were falling, and I thought, you know, this is crazy. Here I am with these two sort of crazy monks way up, you know, here in nowhere, and why are they stopping to cook? I think I later realized that Tashi, the older monk, you know, was not allowed to eat after a certain time, maybe noon, and that was why they actually did that. There you can see it was snowing up there. This pass was something like 16,500 feet high or something like that, at least 16,000 feet. This was, I think, in August, September, around that time. You know, I've seen a thing on maybe Discovery Channel called Zaskar in winter. And in winter, it's totally snowed in there. Like it's like 6 feet of snow. They can really not even go out of the house. I think this was up near the top of the pass, or maybe just coming down. You can see some of the snow was sticking on these plants. The German guys were actually way behind us. One of them was sick. And the Nawang, you know, went back down and took the guy's pack and brought it up to the pass. Eventually they caught up with us. After we crossed that pass, we had to go way down, and then we went up over another little pass, and then this was the view from the top of there. And there you can see their monastery, which is called Lingshed. I think the elevation of Lingshed was about 14,000 feet. And you can see all the little fields around there. That was a closer view as we were approaching Lingshed Monastery. I can see it's also rather spectacularly situated by this huge cliff. Well, it's actually not a cliff, it's a mountain. The first night we stayed in this man's house, He tried to sell us everything in the house, including that necklace and that hat. He also I was tempted to buy a beautiful engraved silver spoon, but I decided it was it belonged there and not, you know, maybe in my mother's house. But I think Tashi told me that he was his father and Nawang's father, but a different mother. And assuming it was his, there was also a, you know, he also had a younger wife and little kids. You know, I don't know what the family situation was. After that, you know, I went to stay in Tashi's place during the remainder of my stay there. There's a Lingshed Gompa, you know, up at the top is the temple, and the other buildings are the monks' quarters. I don't know, Tashi gave me this paper that said it had a history of 1,000 years. Buddhism actually came to Zaskar before it went to Tibet. Tashi asked me to send this picture of him praying. I actually sent him this picture and some of these pictures, and you know, when I got home, and sometime later I actually got a letter from him that said, you know, I should return to Lingshed. I think it said, remember you soon, you know, and it's rather not exactly good English syntax, but it was, you know, at least I knew he got the pictures, which was nice. This is on the balcony, just by the main temple. I was told this mural represents long life. And you can see some of the monks in there are reading some text. There we go. You know, inside the temple, they were always also chanting and reading texts. It was some sort of a festival, a religious festival going on when I was there. It was an old local man, I guess, who came to the, you know, Gompa every day and you know, was fed. You know, periodically they would start, you know, they were drinking their typical salt butter tea that Tibetans drink, and then they would give you some champa, which is the I think it's buckwheat or barley flour that they eat. I had so many cups of this tea that I couldn't get the taste out of my mouth, and I felt like the butter was coming out of my pores. Those two Germans wouldn't even drink it. I didn't really necessarily think of it as tea. I just thought of it as a good drink for that location. This sort of the courtyard of the temple. One day when I was there was a festival, and the local people who, you know, the lay people are the ones who support the temple. They came and presented things to the monks, some of the locals in the temple. I guess the monks also were given money from the villagers, so I don't know, a picture of some monks counting their money. I like that kind of picture. You know, this is that part of Asia is getting towards Central Asia, so some of the people look Western, you know, have sort of blue eyes or fair-haired. So this man looked a little bit like that. Finally, after several days in the Lingshed, I resumed my trek. This time I was alone. This was the next village I came to. I think this man sold me some buttermilk, or gave me some buttermilk. The local people there, after they got to be a certain age, seemed to have really bad eyes. I don't know if it's because of the diet or there's so much bright sunlight, but he wanted me to treat his eyes. It just so happened I had some eye ointment. You know, I put some in just to make him happier. He wanted me to leave the tube with him, but I didn't think that was a good idea. Then I had to climb this huge pass. So that night I slept at the base of the pass. Tashi had guaranteed me that I'd be able to make a fire there and cook something for dinner. But when I got there, the only so-called wood were a couple of little plants. One was really too green to burn, and the other one with these would, you know, like burn up immediately. And I don't know how high I was, probably well over 14,000 feet. Imagine trying to blow on the wood and make a fire at that elevation. Anyway, after much effort, the best I could do was for dinner was eating, you know, champa mixed in lukewarm water. Then during the night, it started to drizzle a couple of times. I didn't have a tent, and I threw my sleeping bag and my stuff over a rock and covered myself with a poncho and just sat until it stopped. It didn't rain very long or very hard. Next day, I climbed up this pass. I'm not sure if I'm still climbing there or... This was probably taken up near the top of the pass. So I believe I was heading into this valley below. There are these, you know, all these strange plants around there when you get up really high. You can see the... I wish I knew more about geology, but you have to wonder what sort of caused all that and that, or is that the same one? All right, then I think the only village in this valley was called Fataxar, which you can see right there. There are some people harvesting. I think I approached these very same people and asked them if I could stay with them and get some food. I learned a few words of Ladakhi, or either Ladakhi or Hindi or Urdu. They probably spoke a few words of Hindi or Urdu. So they said okay, and then and the father led me to the house and immediately, you know, started cooking for everybody. And then the others came. I think this was a roof of some old temple near the village. That was the man I stayed with up on the roof of his house. You can see. He's got really big gold earrings, and Tibetans all have these, prayer banners on the roof of their house, prayer flags. They all have these mantras, prayers written on them. I think I stayed there two nights. At dinner time, they would make a fire and put a pot of water on, and then they'd start making the salt butter tea, and we'd have few cups of that, and then they would, you'd mix some champa in it and eat that with your hand. I think they also made a big loaf of champa, and you'd just take pieces off of that, boiled loaf, and you'd take pieces off of that and dip it in the tea and eat it. I think we ate some rice I was carrying also. When I left there in the morning, I gave them a 20 rupee note, and they seemed very happy. I had the feeling that they'd never seen a 20 rupee note before. It was only worth about $2.50 at the time. I guess to them that was quite a bit of money. That's a woman underneath all that peat or grass. Let's see if I can locate her head. I guess her head would be right there. So it's quite a load. This is, I think, when I was leaving Fataxar, heading over another big pass. It's Fataxar. This is on top of another pass that was something like 16,000 feet high. I think the previous one I'd crossed is over there, on the other end of the valley, or over there. The second day I was in Fataxar, this young Irishman came along, and I hiked with him for 2 or 3 days. So he took this of me up on top of the pass. I remember when we got up there, this big silver-colored eagle with about a 6-foot wingspan floated by. It's probably the Irishman. He was always walking way ahead of me, and I don't know, it seemed to me his head was always down. I didn't know if he was looking at the scenery. He was kind of an interesting young guy. I think he was Protestant, and he told me when he was young, like maybe in his young teens, he was a fanatic, kill the Catholic types. And then he got out of that, and he was he was into long distance running. What he was into more recently was underwater cave exploration. He also told me he'd only been in Asia for first time out of Europe, I think, for a really short time, maybe a couple of weeks. It was the same story with those two Germans I met earlier. I think it's hard to understand a place, someplace like this, if you have, you know, no experience even being in a third world country, let alone somewhere far from, you know, what we'd call modern civilization. Anyway, he told me he'd seen a TV show in Europe that showed in Europe called Zaskar, The Last Place on Earth. And he said it made Zaskar out to be a real paradise. It said that people, you know, all helped each other and so on. And he was very disillusioned. For one thing, he was a vegetarian, and he found out the people there ate meat. Of course, in a place like that where there's so little food, I think that's probably the, you know, the main reason they ate meat. Another thing was he stayed in Lingshed, he stayed with a different monk who, I think, kind of ripped him off, you know, charged him way too much money for his stay there. I think they're not even really supposed to charge you, you know, money or tell you how much to pay when you stay with a monk. I mean, of course, you can give them something. One thing, though, after I left Lingshed, the weather was cloudy, so you know, you couldn't really see or capture in the photos how colorful the mountains were. Although, you know, it's possible Zaskar was exceptional. This is, of course, no longer Zaskar, but you know, it was a bit disappointing because when I was in Zaskar, I mean, the mountains were so colorful, and the colors would sort of change a bit all day long depending where the sun was. We ended up spending the night in this woman's house. I think she was carrying some firewood there on her back. That was probably her village. The scenery was just incredible everywhere. Some side canyon there. I think you could see my trail over on the right there. I don't know, the scenery just kept changing and being more bizarre. I think at one point I kind of wondered what planet I was on. This part may not look too interesting, but these kind of formations were like just huge clumps of earth and rocks kind of, you know, bonded together. It was strange. I met these other Americans in Leh, and they overheard me talking with somebody else about the trek I had made, and started asking me about it, and they did that trek in the opposite direction. And then some weeks later, I ran into them again in India, and first I ran into the woman in the three, and she said, you know, at first they thought it was really hard and they wanted to kill me, but then they realized how amazing it was. And then I saw one of the other people, and I said to him, I hear you wanted to kill me. And he said, no, I want to thank you. this valley was a little lower down, probably like about 10,000 feet, you know, whereas Lingshed and Fataksar were 14,000 feet, didn't have any trees. So, you know, they had a lot of willow trees around there, also some apple trees and maybe apricot trees. This was the last village I stayed in on my trek. Up at the top was another temple. I stayed with a Kashmiri man, not a local people, who was there. I forget if he was a teacher or whatever he was doing there, but I guess any passerby he put up in his place for, you know. I think, you know, he said the local people were very nice but simple. I think that, you know, Muslims tend to look down on the local people there. You know, the local people also practice polyandry. Sometimes two brothers will share one wife. I guess the wife and the children actually belong to the older brother. I think this town was called Wanla, village. There were two of the local monks. You know, in Tibetan Buddhism, or at least in, you know, places, remote places like this, usually the second and third sons are sent at a young age, 5 or 6 years old, to become monks. This is me crossing the final pass on the trek. Actually, I was alone, but I guess I used the 10-second thing on my camera. It was similar to the pass I crossed with the Tashi and Nawang, except not nearly so high or far. By the way, as you can see, the sky was quite blue in that part of the world. This must have been taken up near the top. All right, this is Lama Yuru Temple. I came, out at the end of this valley up, and then into this valley and looked up to the left, and that was the view of the temple where I was finishing my trek. The road, main road, goes past there. And then as I walked along there to the temple, people were in the field harvesting, and they were singing as they were harvesting. So it was a very nice way to end the trek. Another view of Lama Yuru. I was on the road waiting for a bus to go to Leh, which is the main town in Ladakh. And I ended up getting a ride with these three Kashmiri men in a 1947 Chevy that, periodically broke down. All three of these men were mechanics. I remember at one point, it had a stick shift on the column. I remember at one point the stick shift came out of the column. That was actually taken from the road looking down at the, I think it's the Indus River. This is in Leh. This was the palace in Leh where the king lived. It's modeled after the Patola Palace in Lhasa. And that's looking down on Leh from, I think it climbed up towards the palace. This is in the Indus Valley. This was again in 1980. I think Leh has grown and changed completely. I have a feeling the other places that you've seen on these slides, these little out-of-the-way villages, probably haven't changed at all. It would certainly be interesting to try to go and see if the Tashi and Nawang are still around there. I don't know. I guess if we went to Zaskar, maybe I'd bring copies of those photos and see if. I could locate any of those people, give them or their families those photos. Of course, it's over 20 years later. I think this was the king's temple. This is up above the palace, somewhere up in the valley near Leh. This was a street scene in Leh. I guess a market scene. You can see the Ladakhi hats, and if anyone's ever been to India, Indian postbox, mailbox. I think most of the merchants in Leh were, Muslims from Kashmir. I'm not sure what the situation is like now. I know that, Ladakhis don't really like being part of Kashmir, which is, dominated by Muslims who, I think that they don't want to be part of Kashmir. By the way, I should have mentioned at the beginning, but Ladakh used to be known as Little Tibet, and I think it was never politically part of Tibet, but culturally and socially and geographically is basically part of Tibet. The people might have different strains because of the interaction of other people in that area or those who passed through that area a long time ago. This was at the bus station. A couple of Buddhist stupas, and on the right there's a sign that said, "Hope you enjoyed my curve, Sweet 16," which I guess shows the sense of humor of Indian truck drivers. Nearby was this pass that was reputed to be the highest road in the world. Foreigners weren't allowed over there. I don't know if these trucks went over there, maybe supplying the Indian army or something. I don't know if the name of the road was 16. This was another monastery, down the road from Leh. Can't think of the name right now. Anyway, as usual, you can see the temple at the top, very big. And the monks lived in these other buildings. I don't know what this one in the middle was. Another spectacular sight. This was in the same town. They're threshing the harvest, crushing it by using several animals. I don't know whether they have a horse and a goat and a yak. You can see the prayer banners on the roof of the house. This is the same photo. The other one was taken with, I think, a telephoto lens or a zoom lens, and this is with a regular lens. There's actually a woman who's doing the work. As far as I could tell, at least from my brief experience, it seemed pretty equal with the men and the women working in the, doing the work there. By the way, I didn't mention, but all these slides are taken with Kodachrome 64, which I think was the best slide film. And I had one of those old Minolta SRT 101s. And I think I had maybe a 35 and a 55 and a 135 lens. There's Indus Valley. I guess a pretty wide part. And I guess this is the road, paved road, nice paved road. So some other people, again, doing some threshing over there with a few animals. There's the palace in Leh again from the side. I think there's the palace and there's the temple that you saw before. And it's from another angle. There's the palace and the temple. This may have been taken in like late afternoon, which is why the lighting is like that. It's Indus Valley. I went to a temple a few hours from there called Alchi, which was special because it was still the way it was built 1,000 years ago. Alchi was across the river and I think not on the main route, so it hadn't been destroyed by invaders or anything like the other ones. So it was quite an ancient temple and I think had some unusual or special features. I remember when I was there was a some sort of Tibetan scholar and he seemed to be quite interested in it. So one of the doors looks quite old. I guess some wooden dragons up at the top there carved up. It's the Indus River. It looked quite amazing because of the sort of blue color against all the barren slopes. This is on the roof of the house I stayed in. You can see the moon and all the Tibetan prayer banners. It's around Alchi. I don't know how well you can tell from the TV camera. The slope's kind of purplish colored. There it is again. There's Alchi, this trail. I think those mountains are Leh is somewhere below those mountains, I believe. That was the kids of the family I stayed with in Alchi. I think the father was a local postmaster. This I took on the bus going back to Leh. A lot of Tibetans sit all day and spin their prayer wheel and chant. As I say there, religion is really part of the everyday life. I've seen around Leh. Finally, I was heading out of Ladakh back to Kashmir. I guess that's the road. The Indians built a good road from Kashmir, from Srinagar to Leh, in part because it's, important area near, Pakistan. They have to supply the army. There's a lot of Indian army around there. In those days, obviously now there's more. They also, I think, taught the locals how to grow vegetables. And like in the Leh area, the vegetables were the most delicious vegetables I've ever tasted. I didn't know things like carrots and cauliflower could taste so good. Just another scene of that Kashmir-Leh road. You see the road there. It was only open to private traffic certain hours of the day. It was closed because I don't know if it handled two-way traffic that well, but the Indian Army had these big caravans. One of the villages along the road. This is in a town called Kargil. As I mentioned earlier, the western part of Ladakh is a Muslim area, and Kargil is the only real big town or town that you pass between Srinagar and Leh. This I took early in the morning. I'd actually stayed over in Kargil on the way to Zaskar, and again, this was in 1980 when the when they had the American hostages in Iran, and this area, the people are, you know, Shiite or Shia Muslims like in Iran, and they actually had posters of Ayatollah Khomeini all over the village, and they had some other posters. One of them was sort of, I think it was the Muslims' Christmas greeting to Christians. But then another one was about, you know, Iran. I remember it said, kill the executioner Carter. And they started blaring the, you know, in the evening when they read the Quran, they started blaring, broadcasting the Quran all over the town. I guess the place I was staying at, the guy didn't care for it because he left the music going while that was happening. This was a butcher shop in Kargil. You know, the main food of the Muslims in that part of the world is a mutton. So he gets an important job. This is a place I think called Dras, which is actually the first town you come to when you go from Kashmir into Ladakh. And I'd heard or read it, that it was the second coldest place in Asia after some place in Siberia, and I kind of thought that sounded ridiculous. You know, in my travels I often heard something was the, you know, the most or the est or something like that, and usually I found that was not the case, so I thought. But anyway, I froze to death the night I stayed in Dras. I think I stayed in some little, you know, stone or clay hut. And I did have a down sleeping bag, but it was really cold. This is called a white-capped river chat. I thought I would add this slide here. I think it was the only time I managed to photograph one. I'd spent, you know, quite a bit of time in the Himalayas in India and Nepal and then Ladakh. And I would see this bird everywhere in the Himalayas along streams. They sing and along the stream, and as they sing, their tail goes up and down. So I finally got, you know, this one photo of one. This was probably the last evening I stayed in Ladakh. And finally, there's a picture of me in the hammock. Anyway, in a houseboat in, you know, in Srinagar in Kashmir after my Ladakh. Zaskar and Ladakh adventure. And, you know, as I said, this was part of a 2-year trip I made in Asia, and it was definitely, you know, one of the highlights, if not the highlight of that trip. I also did a lot of other traveling in South America, Europe, and later I lived in Japan and Korea and traveled in China, and I would say that was definitely one of the highlights, and I have a lot of great slides from all of these places, but I think these are, you know, maybe the best ones and the most interesting. Yeah, I would love to go there again. I don't know the situation, you know, because of what's happening in Kashmir. I imagine there are not many tourists going to, you know, Kashmir or Ladakh these days. You know, I would think as far as that Amarnath cave, I would imagine Hindu pilgrims are not going to that cave these days. I don't think it would be safe. You can go to Leh. There was also a road from going to Leh from the south, from Himachal Pradesh, which is probably the way you'd have to go there now or fly. I don't think you can go from Kashmir because it's such a sensitive area there now. I don't know if you could go there at all. I actually, when I did this show in the gallery in Springfield, I told one of my Tibetan students here about it, and she came with they came late, but she came with about half a dozen Tibetan friends and with a monk from Leh, who's from Leh, so that was nice. Yeah, he said it changed a lot since then. But sure, yeah, sure. It'd be fantastic to go back. But I don't, you know, I don't know if it's in the cards.
Well, thank you.
Plus, you know, I don't know if I'd have to get into a lot better shape than I am right now to, you know, to do that trek again. I'd probably have to get a porter to carry my pack and maybe another porter to carry me. You know, it was not the easiest thing to do. You know, as you can see, I was, you know, far lighter in those days, and my legs were probably a lot stronger.